Will you please reiterate swale best practices here? While there are circumstances which could change things, what is the rule of thumb for how deep and wide to make them? How far apart to space them, and how to plan ahead for eventual downslope saturation? Will the bottom swale always eventually transform into a wet terrace? Well, it's pretty hard to give a rule of thumb on swales, unfortunately. You could start by looking at the size of the property. You don't have a small property with a big, large, wide swale like that, right? Because it's going to take up too much of the property, and property is totally unnecessary. So small properties usually only have small swales. So if it's an urban block of land, you wouldn't want a swale this big. That's kind of obvious. So as you go up in property size, you tend to potentially go up in the size of a swale in width. Now, that usually means that it's wide enough to get the main machine down, usually a tractor or a large ride-on mower or a quad bike or something like that. A quad bike swale is a bit smaller than a tractor swale. Then how deep and how wide? Well, the width I've just talked about usually come, I like to think about a wheelbarrow width swale on a large garden. If you're on a really, really small garden, it might be smaller than a wheelbarrow width. It might actually be under the mulch, and not even a footpath as a dual function. But a swale can function as a footpath in dry times. That's not a good footpath right now because it's full of water because we had massive rain last night, which is unusual in winter. But it's good for our example here. This is fed from a big dam next to my house, and it's coming under a dribbler pipe, so the driveway, the spillway stays dry. If we get massive rains, the dribbler pipe won't take it either. So we're getting ready. If there's a big rain, it'll still come over the driveway for a few hours maybe. But back to sizes. On flatter country, where you've only got little tiny slopes, you're gonna go down into the ground to build the mound. So you're gonna go below grade. As you get up on slopes, you're gonna go into the hill to get the material. So you're gonna cut in on horizontal to make the mound. So there's a difference. As you get onto flatter country, you're going below ground to dig the trench to put the mound up. On steeper and steeper country, you're more and more straight into the hill to make the mound. Now, if it gets too steep, your back cut gets to be too big. And that gets to be the controlling mechanism on steepness. As you get steeper, the back cut that you're cutting off the hill, which has to be sloped back for stability, we're always talking about stability in earthworks, especially permaculture earthworks, you're gonna lay that back cut back. Depending on the material, on the angle, the average there is 1.5 to 1, for one up rise to 1.5 run. Rise to run is the way you talk about it in America. So that's important to take into consideration. Now, when you get to climate, as you get into the dry lands where there is less rain and more evaporation, you less and less rain and more evaporation as you get into the real hyper-arid, you want bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger swales. The biggest swales, the Amazon of swales, are going to be in the large landscapes of the hyper-arid. Why, you ask? Doesn't rain much, but when it does rain, it all comes at once. A desert is a flood waiting to happen. It's a saying for you. So you get large rains just for a few hours, once or twice a year, or maybe once every other year or so. When that happens, you need to capture all the water and retain it into the soil, because that's what they do. They soak into the soil, take the water away from the sun's evaporative forces, therefore retaining the water for longer. Here, we have a bamboo swale in this case. The water's going into the ground and it's feeding the roots of that beautiful old hamii bamboo, which is a great edible and a timber. So, and a forage. So you've got to think about where you're putting a swale, in what size landscape, in what steepness of slope, into what machinery you're going to be using, which usually relates to the size of the property. And so there's no rule of thumb here. There's multiple rules for multiple thumbs. So you've got to think about that, right? Is it a humid climate where you don't need to trap so much water? When you have massive rains and everything's flooded and all the dams are full and there's water running everywhere, swales aren't doing much at all because everything's already wet. But when you get light rains in dry periods, they're doing a lot. And they retain water for a long time because water movement over the surface is extremely fast and rapid and often erosive if it's not controlled the right way. Swales are never erosive because you can see that water is extremely passive. You've got water coming in on a pipe, it's flowing. It flows for a little tiny section, then it sits flat. It's like a tide. It just rises and falls as it soaks in or more rain arrives. But when the water goes into the topsoil and subsoil, it's moving at right angle to contour, just like it would be at the surface, but it's going very, 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 very slowly. This water might take over a year to get off the property down to the lower slopes and into the creek on our bottom boundary. Now, the distance between swales, that's debatable. Yeomans and Mollison both said the height of the trees, the potential height of the trees, being that swales are tree growing systems, that's what they mainly are. You can have swale type features in gardens, but mainly the definitive swale is a tree growing system. The height, the potential height of the trees at full grown, taken horizontally are back to the slope. So you draw a horizontal line from the height of that bamboo to the next swale on the slope. So it's a stepping process. The height of the trees, potentially, step back horizontally is where you can put the next swale and on up the hill. So the steeper it gets, the closer they're going to get together. And the shallower it gets, the further apart they are. Now that's just a basic rule of thumb. You can put them a little bit closer if there's a reason for it, or if they're catching particular types of water flows. The problem comes when you're getting them really, really flat, they're going to be too far apart. If you've got a very, very flat landscape, they're going to be miles apart or kilometers apart. So as you get into the flat country, what you consider a flat landscape or flat-ish landscape, you want to put your swales in relation to the wind. So how close do you need to put your swells so you get a nice wind shelter in between? Why wind? Because in a flat landscape, you get a lot of wind because there's nothing to stop the wind because it's all flat. So it's always a windy landscape when it's flat or potentially. So if you can position your swells so that trees that grow on the swells give you a nice sheltered landscape between, you've not only got water saturation and soakage and storage and extension, and nutrient catch in that water, which all happens with swales, you've also got wind protection on the flat. Now, your last part of the question here, Chloe, is a rather unusual one, and that is, will the bottom swale always eventually transform into a wet terrace? No, it depends how many swales you've got. If you only got two, the bottom one's not necessarily going to be a wet terrace. Maybe if you've got 20, it's not either in an arid landscape. Which landscape are we talking about? If you're talking about a very humid landscape with very large rains, with multiple swales coming down the hill, then possibly yes, but not always. It really does depend on how much rain you have over what period, you know, extended over a year. So that is really climatically different, and how many swales you have coming down the slope. But it can happen. It can happen, and when it does, it's a wonderful thing because then you have a Chenampa canal on the side of the hill you didn't even have to seal. And that's almost seeming like an impossibility, but it can work with the soakage plumes of swales connecting up down a sloping landscape if there's enough of them and you have enough rain. But it doesn't always happen. But if you start to envision the landscape looking like that, it's an amazing thing. It's an incredible thing. It's an incredible snapshot. It's time scouting forward into the future. And we ought to be optimistic. So that's something that's going to take 7 years of soakage. So the average full saturation, in other words, the plume underneath this swale, it's going to get a little bit bigger every year, rainy season after rainy season, year after year, to about 7 years, and then it won't catch any more in the subterranean plume of moisture, dampness underneath this swell. And that's the same with all swells in all climates. And that's an interesting statement made by Bill Mollison, but if you think it through, it's probably all to do with sun cycles from the wettest years to the driest years over roughly 15 years, with seven being right in the middle. So no matter where you start, you've either climbed to the wettest or dropped to the driest, and you've got the average in the 7 years to get to the volume that then, when it rains, it charges up the quickest and surplus recharges aquifers, and any extra goes through the subsurface and recharges spring lines lower down the slope.